It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Premier, your government spent over $250 million of taxpayers' money on the Social Assistance Management System, or SAMS. The system was supposed to improve the delivery of social assistance for recipients of Ontario Works and the Ontario Disability Support Program. The Minister of Community and Social Services, in fact, said during a November 4, 2014 meeting of the Estimates Committee that she felt fairly confident that the new system will have a pretty seamless rollout. Premier, we don't need another e-health. So will your government recall the Estimates Committee so we can hear directly from witnesses and frontline workers to get to the bottom and to help you with this, get out of this another Liberal scandal?
So I appreciate the question from the member opposite, and I just want to step back and say that the reason that this new system is being implemented, Mr. Speaker, is that there was an outdated computer system in place. This new system is designed ultimately to allow for better service to clients, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that frontline workers will be able to spend more time with clients, that clients will have a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week access to online information, Mr. Speaker, and more information about their cases. And, Mr. Speaker, the reality is that there was a glitch. I understand that. And there are 500,000 checks that go out every month, Mr. Speaker. There was a problem with a portion of those. My understanding is that less than 1% now, a little over 100 checks, still need to be dealt with, but that 99% of the error has been corrected, Mr. Speaker.
Before we get going, I'm going to ask for the stop of the injections into this conversation. Supplementary.
And to the Premier, Premier, government continues to demonstrate an inability to manage Ontarians' best interests. Your minister signed off on this expensive new system, a $250 million system that was flawed from the beginning, and you were forewarned. A letter written by OPSU President Warren Smokey Thomas in July to your minister responsible stated, quote, unless improvements are made to SAMS, the launch in late fall will be rife with problems, delays, and poor service, end of quote. Premier, Ontario's most vulnerable rely on these payments. I don't believe you, and I don't think anyone believes that 99% of the problem is fixed at this point. So what is your government going to do to make sure these people aren't left behind, that they have their money for Christmas?
Well, Mr. Speaker, and I would welcome Smokey Thomas to the legislature today. He's here, and I'm sure that he shares with me a desire to make sure that clients of the system get the very best service possible. The system that was in place was outdated, Mr. Speaker. There was an overpayment error. It was caught immediately, Mr. Speaker. Within 24 hours, about 99% of the payments were stopped or they were retracted immediately. There's about 1%, a little over 100 situations that still need to be dealt with, Mr. Speaker. But I'm sure the leader of the opposition is not saying that there should never be change. I'm sure he's not saying that we should never update a system and make sure that caseworkers would have more time with clients.
Because
that is what we are doing. We are in the business of improving service to the people of Ontario, Mr. Speaker, making sure that people get better service. And along the way, when there is a situation like this, we act quickly to rectify it. And that is what has happened in this situation, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Premier, you only acted after the fact. Mr. Thomas warned you back in July, the president of OPSU. He told you his members were telling him that there would be major problems with the rollout. He was exactly right.
Deputy House Leader,
so
come to
why
work.
Didn't you heed his warnings? Why did you buy an expensive program that doesn't appear to work from the get-go? And why are you moving forward defending this when it's just going to turn out to be another Liberal scandal? How much is this Liberal scandal going to cost us?
Premier.
Mr. Community and Social Services.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm pleased to have the opportunity to set the record straight on the error that occurred last week. I think it's worth knowing that SAMS is a technology that uses the Curum case management software, the same platform that is used in many jurisdictions globally, now owned by IBM. We have a contract with them to assist us through the transition of going live with SAMS. As the Premier has stated, clearly this this is a new system that is replacing a totally outdated computer system. It'll bring our services into the 21st century. We have spent the last many months training the users on SAMS, both some 11,000 users, both in municipal OW offices as well as ODSP offices. Extremely extensive training. We thank the workers for all their hard work, but clearly the opposition is trying to make a mountain out of a very small molehill. Thank you.
New question, Leader of the Opposition.
It's also for the Premier. Premier, last week your health minister bowed to public outrage and provided the Erie St. Clair Community Care Access Centre with an additional $4.1 million towards their deficit. Premier, there are 14 CCACs in Ontario. Throughout the province, CCACs are being forced to claw back health care services because of budgetary pressures. Earlier this year, my colleague, the member for Dufferin-Caledon, brought to your attention the fact that the Central West CCAC would have to cut the number of new patients it could accept. That is, despite the fact that since 2010, the amount of patients needing the CCAC services has nearly doubled. Premier, is your health minister going to provide new funding for all CCACs?
Shout it. Thank you, Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, and I know that the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care will want to speak to this in the supplementary, but the fact is we're investing more than $4.3 billion in the community sector, Mr. Speaker, and we've increased that funding by $270 million this year, Mr. Speaker, in 2014-15. So we continue to invest more in the community sector, Mr. Speaker, and as I have said many times in this House, we are in a transition. There is no doubt about that. We are changing the way we deliver health services in Ontario. People want care in their homes. They want care in the community, and we are moving to a system that provides much more of that care in the community, Mr. Speaker. But we know we have to continue to work with the CCACs, work with the community or agencies, Mr. Speaker, to make sure that people get the care that they need when they need it. To that end, we continue to invest and increase funding to that sector, Mr. Speaker.
Premier, Mr. Speaker, Premier, the Canadian Union of Public Employees, CUPE, says there's been a 33% spike in the demand for home care. We can expect this trend to continue as our population ages. CUPE says the Southwest Community Care Access Centre, and the NDP obviously think this is funny, which services patients in a large geographical area from London to Grey Bruce, is resorting to cutting care for some ill patients, denying care to others altogether. Premier, do you believe the $250 million you squandered on the failed SAMS computer system could have been better used to help people who need care through our CCACs?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question. Mr. Speaker, we're investing more than $4 billion this year in home and community care across the province. That's an increase of more than $250 million from last year. But I want to talk about what we're particularly proud of. We've got a team that's being led right now by Gail Donner, and those in the home and community sector see this woman for the experience that she's got and the leadership that she's providing to help us look at our home and community sector as we continue to transform as a province and transform our health care system. We've been focusing, Mr. Speaker, as everyone in this legislature knows over the past several years on our acute care facilities. Now we're beginning to turn our attention in a very substantive way to home and community care. We know there are improvements that need to be made. We know that we need to make sure that we're providing the highest quality of care to people where they need it as close to home as possible. We're working on that, and with Gail Donner's leadership, I expect to report back in January. I'm sure that we're going to have solid recommendations to help us guide us into the future.
Final supplementary.
Again to the Premier. Premier, our CCACs have their backs against the wall. The reason they're not receiving adequate funding is because the government has dug a deep fiscal hole. Over a decade of Liberal mismanagement means we're spending millions and servicing debt interest payments and waste. That money should be invested towards safeguarding frontline health care and providing for patients in need. Premier, your health minister even vowed to, quote, personally address any issues with specific clients who say they are not getting the care they needed. And to quote, well, we're hearing dozens of stories by the day, hundreds by the week. So, Premier, have you asked your minister to directly report to you about these individual cases? And if so, how many house calls has the good doctor made?
Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'd be happy to make a few house calls if that is going to lead us down that important path of continuing to improve our health care system. But I want the same thing that I did privately with the NDP last week. I want to do publicly, not just with the Conservatives, but with the NDP, to actually implore them. If they have specific examples, and I suspect if they have specific.
The member from Essex, come to order. The member from Dufferin-Caledon, come to order. The member from Essex, second time.
Party. In fact, with my colleagues on this side of the legislature as well, it's an important part of my job. It's a responsibility as a Minister of Health and as a health care professional I take very, very seriously. So I would ask them if they are aware through their constituency offices or elsewhere, if they're aware of specific individuals that whose health is being compromised because of what they perceive or a real or actual change in the support that they're providing at home in the community, I would ask them to bring those specific cases to my attention, and I commit to working with them to resolve them.
Your question, the leader of the third party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Nearly a million people rely on social assistance to put food on the table and a roof over their head, Speaker. But the Liberals' new software program is causing chaos for clients and staff. How could the Premier sign off on a $250 million lemon, frankly, having been warned in advance that it could turn into a nightmare for our province's most vulnerable, Speaker?
Well, Mr. Speaker, and I will answer this question again. The fact is there was an outdated system in place that needed to be upgraded, Mr. Speaker. We needed to improve the service to the people of the province who rely on social assistance. And we needed to have in place a system that was going to allow frontline workers to have more time with their clients, caseworkers having more time with their clients. So that's what this system is about, Mr. Speaker. 500,000 checks go out every month. There was an error earlier in the month, Mr. Speaker, earlier this week. It was immediately caught. Within 24 hours, 99% of the payments were stopped or they were retracted, Mr. Speaker. Ministry officials are working to make sure that that final 1% of the cases gets dealt with.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, folks on social assistance trust the government to get things right, but the Liberals rolled out a program full of bugs, causing a $20 million glitch. Payments are being lost, checks are being delayed, people are suffering, and staff are at their wits' end, Speaker. Can the Premier tell me how many Ontarians faced empty cupboards this past weekend and what the government did to help them? Speaker, the first question that I asked of my staff this morning was whether people who were relying on these checks did get their money. And my understanding is that they did, that there are still about 100 or so checks that need to be rectified. Not that people didn't get checks, but that the amounts need to be clarified, Mr. Speaker. So, to my understanding, to the best of my ability, I asked this question, and to my understanding, people did get their money, and there were about 1% of the situations where there still needs to be some change, Mr. Speaker. But the fact is the ministry acted immediately, and 99% of the cases were dealt with. And all of that, Mr. Speaker, speaks to how important it is, obviously, that we be vigilant, but it does not suggest that there should never be change. It does not suggest that we shouldn't update systems. It does not suggest that we shouldn't put in place a system that allows caseworkers to spend more time with their clients. Speaker, the Liberals' $250 million app is full of bugs, and it's causing havoc for people on social assistance. The most vulnerable people deserve better than trial and error, Speaker. They deserve a social assistance program that actually works for them. How can the Premier allow the most vulnerable Ontarians to pay for the Liberals' mistakes?
Thank you.
Speaker, you know, those are broad, sweeping generalizations that bear little or no resemblance to what's actually going on. The ministry trained 11,000 users to make sure that they knew what was required with the new system, Mr. Speaker. And in addition to that, because there was this error, there are now staff being deployed to go to offices to make sure that those final problems get worked out. So, the fact is, we made a change. Yeah, I am very, very clear, Mr. Speaker, that it was necessary to make a change to put a better system in place. And When there was an error, there was an immediate reaction, and there continues to be a reaction, Mr. Speaker, that gives support to those frontline workers to make sure that people have the money that they need. And that, you know, that was my concern this morning, was to make sure that people who are counting on those checks got them, and that has happened, Mr. Speaker.
A new question, Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My next question is also for the Premier. Will the Premier tell the parents of children in youth detention centres, mental health facilities, schools for the severely disabled, some of the most vulnerable kids in Ontario, why she's preventing the child advocate from protecting the rights of their children?
Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, what I would say to the Leader of the Third Party and to all of those people who are paying very close attention to advocacy and accountability in this province is that we are expanding the authority of the child advocate, Mr. Speaker. We are increasing the powers, and in fact, the measures that are contained in Bill 8 were ones that the child advocate was very positive about when we first brought them in, Mr. Speaker. My understanding is that the current requests are things that go beyond the mandate of the child advocate, but we've expanded the authority of the child advocate. We have done that in the bill, Mr. Speaker, and as that bill works through the legislature, the child advocate will have more authority, not less authority, Mr. Speaker, and that is as it should be.
Thank you. Supplementary.
The Premier seems more interested in talking about accountability than she does about doing anything about it. Experts call Bill 8 troubling. Experts, Speaker, are calling Bill 8 troubling. They say it falls seriously short. Experts like the Child Advocate, Patients Canada, and the Ontario Association of Children's Aid Society have some serious concerns about the gaps that are currently existing in Bill 8. So why isn't the Premier interested in what the experts have to say on transparency and accountability, Speaker?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I know that the Minister of Children and Youth Services is going to want to comment on the final supplementary, but, you know, we have worked with many experts, Mr. Speaker, including the experts that the Leader of the Third Party is talking about. We actively consulted with the child advocate as we drafted Bill 8, Mr. Speaker, and we appreciate the feedback that that we got from him in his office. We've accepted amendments that the advocate brought forward. We've accepted amendments to the bill that we consulted with him about, Mr. Speaker. Now, the fact is, Bill 8 expands the powers of the child advocate, Mr. Speaker. The NDP voted against, or plans, I understand, plans to vote against our legislation, but the fact is that we are expanding the authority of the child advocate. We are increasing his powers, Mr. Speaker, and we are creating advocacy and accountability in the health care system that didn't exist before, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you.
So I hope that the third party would be able to work with us on this.
Final supplementary.
Well, Speaker, the Liberals' so-called transparency bill seems to be more about slapping a nice name on a Stephen Harper's-type omnibus bill than it is about increasing transparency in our province, Speaker. When something as basic as addressing Aboriginal children and youth being cared for.
Stop the clock, please. The member from Eglinton Lawrence might himself be withdrawn. Please finish.
When something as basic, Speaker, as addressing Aboriginal children and youth being cared for by Children's Aid Societies is left out, people wonder what the heck is going on. Why is the Premier shutting out the advice of people like the Child Advocate?
The Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Speaker. We are definitely not shutting out the advice of the provincial advocate. We have met with the advocate, Speaker, numerous times. And the reason we're expanding powers, we're recommending expansion of his investigatory powers to Children's Aid Society is because it's a natural fit. Children don't have a natural voice. We thought it's a perfect fit that the advocate oversee Children's Aid Societies, and we know there's been a general call for that. I want to also assure the member of the third party and everybody in this House that for every other ministry program under the Ministry of Children and Youth Services, The Ombudsman has investigatory powers, Speaker. I mentioned last week in the House that he does have powers to investigate things like youth justice facilities. We are extending the powers of Children's Aid Society. We feel the advocate is well positioned for that, given his background, and he'll do a great job in the interest of children and youth. Thank you.
Please, new question, the member from McKee and Carleton.
Speaker, and good morning to you. My question is to the Minister of Education. Bill 10 will likely pass this week after limited and sparse public debate and public consultation. Given the minister's personal commitment to Bill 10 and her desire, can she provide a detailed assessment of how many child care spaces will be impacted by her plan? In other words, can she tell us how many fewer child care spaces there will be in Ontario as a result of her bill? Thank you.
Minister of Education.
Yes. Actually, the good news in child care is if you look at the number of spaces that have been created over the last several years, not only have we created 130,000 since 2003, if you look at each of the last several years, we've created on average 18,000 a year. We have no reason to think that that's going to change, that we will see any slowdown in the creation of high-quality spaces for our children. So we would anticipate that, in fact, we'll see in the next several years over 70,000 new spaces created. In particular, if the licensed child home operators take advantage of the opportunities, we could see 6,000 more spaces just in private home child
care. Thank you. Supplementary.
The impending crisis. In addition, this was the same minister over a year and a half ago who told me that reopening contracts didn't cost $500 million, yet the auditor last week just did tell us that. The ministry knows the range of lost child care spaces will be 140,000 child care spaces as a result of what the Coalition of Independent Child Care Providers suggested, up to 180,000 if we follow the Ombudsman's numbers. Bill 10 is not about safety. We should be talking about hiring more inspectors if that were the case, or ensuring we had stronger enforcements and regulations are creating an independent registry, but we're not. Instead, we're talking about eliminating spaces, changing pedagogy of Montessori and private religious schools, and eliminating parental choice. So I ask the minister finally and once and for all, in the name of transparency, will she tell this assembly how many child care spaces her government is going to eliminate?
Thank you, Minister.
Yes, and I'm glad that the member mentioned some of those safety factors because, Speaker, I'd like to tell you what the Tories proposed to do to Bill 10 with their amendments. For example, they were going to limit the scope of child care to children under 10 years of age, which would have had the effect of removing subsidies from a number of very needy children. That was what they were going to do. They were, despite the evidence from Yellowwood, actually going to increase the number of children above and beyond what we put in Bill 10 who are allowed in private home child care centers, despite all the problems we've had. They were going to remove the new administrative penalties from the bill. That's what actually allows us to go in and fine people. And they were going to limit the protection orders where you get to actually close places down. They were going to...
Thank you. New question, member from Bramley, Gordon Walton.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Finance. Mr. Speaker, this government claims to be a government based on transparency and accountability. I hope we'll see that in the answer to this question. According to the Fall Economic Statement in early November of this year, the first annual Automobile Insurance Transparency and Accountability Expert Report was delivered to the Minister of Finance. Now, the whole point of this report was to let the public know why premiums are staying so high despite the fact that we had draconian benefit cutbacks in 2010 and subsequent years that reduced the cost for insurance companies. But despite promising over a week ago, and I quote this, to make the public make this report public momentarily, the government has refused to release it. What's in this report that the government does not want the 8 million drivers of Ontario to know about?
Question. Thank you. Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Yes, last year our government took leadership in launching the auto insurance cost and reduction rate strategy. something that I thought that member opposite would have been supportive of, given that it would have initiated the ability for us to reduce the cost of claims, enabling us to reduce the cost of premiums. And we are doing so, obviously now, without their support. We did commission a report that would have been available to us much sooner, of course, had we not had an unwanted election, again prompted by that party. So we will continue to do our work. We'll have the report out in due course. We're reviewing it now, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, the Minister of Finance weeks ago said this report would be out momentarily. Where is the report? The fact is, you said you would release this report momentarily, and you haven't. New Democrats have long argued that the insurance company has already pocketed billions of dollars of savings, but none of those savings have been passed on to drivers. That's why we called for a 15% premium cutback. We are the ones who championed this cause for the people of Ontario. We voted against a bill that stripped the right to sue from people of Ontario, that stripped the right for people to stand up to insurance companies, and we probably did so. Our question, though, very directly to the Minister of Finance is, why won't you release this transparency report? Why are you delaying? And what's in this report that you don't want people to know about?
Yeah.
Thank you. Minister?
So what the people should know, Mr. Speaker, is the history that's gone to get to where we are now, and the constant obstacles that have been that we had to deal with, primarily from the third party in many circumstances. Since 2003, we introduced the auto insurance rate stabilization. In 2005, we introduced regulations to prohibit auto insurance from using certain information, such as credit scoring. In 2008, we completed our first five-year review of the auto insurance system. In 2010, we provided new reforms for increased consumer choices to vacate stabilized rates. In 2011, we created the Auto Insurance Anti-Task Force. In 2012, we strengthened FISCO's authority to deal with unfair practices. In 2013, we made a commitment to reduce auto insurance rates by 15%. We introduced legislation this week so that we can get this underway, and it was voted against by that member, by that party, Mr. Speaker. Our report is in hand.
Senator, please, new question, the member from Burlington.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I have a question for the Premier. The International Organization of the Francophonie, it's an organization that's made of five member states and also associate members.
Starting as a small group of northern French-speaking countries, the Francophonie has since evolved into a global organization whose numerous branches cooperate with its member states in the fields of culture, science, economy, justice and peace. Speaker, as a Canadian, I am proud of our rich French heritage and our participation with La Francophonie. Premier, yesterday Canadians heard the news that former Governor-General Michel Jean has been chosen as Secretary-General of La Francophonie. The first woman and the first Canadian to lead this vital organization. Madame la Premier ministre, quelle est votre réaction?
Madame Premier, what is your reaction concerning that historical news? Thank you. I'm going to congratulate Madame Michaëlle Jean. She's been
Secretary General of the Organisation Internationale de Francophonie as the first woman. And the first Canadian to hold this position, Madame Jean, is breaking down barriers. Notre communauté francophone fait partie.
Our francophone community is a part of our history as Ontarians and Canadians in our past and in our future. The nomination of Mrs. Jean reflects this. So we are extremely proud for our Canadian. We are going to support Mrs. Jean. And we have an international francophonie that's going to show that we'll have more women and more young people, and also the north and the south will be united.
Merci, Monsieur le Président, et merci, Madame la Première
ministre. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Madame Premier. It's certainly good news. Francophonie, it's not just an organization for international groups. Mr. Speaker, does the Premier, in her role, can tell us what is the role of Francophonie on the international stage?
Vaste est le monde francophone.
Thank you, Chairman.
the International Association of the Francophonie is an organization that gathers together hundreds of millions of people, and it has made an excellent choice, and we participated actively in the recent summit. And I am very proud to congratulate my compatriot Michaëlle John for her recent election, and it is an honor for Madame Jean, who was a candidate in spite of the obstacles to her candidacy, and she will gather together the people of the Francophonie. The position of Secretary General of the Francophonie is, this is the first time that is a woman and a Canadian who is at the head of the organization.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Infrastructure. Minister, your sheer incompetence running the government portfolio is having deep consequences for the people of Ontario. You've wasted over $400 million on a building that was supposed to be dedicated to medical research. Instead, you've invested that money into a comfy glass palace for your bureaucrats rather than frontline services. Simply put, that money could have been invested in just about anything else, and it would have been money better spent. Minister, do you not agree that the money you've blown on Mars should have been invested into improving our essential services?
Thank you. Minister of Economic Development,
Mr. Speaker,
and infrastructure. Got to get it all out.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We struggle with this every time, don't we? The long name, Premier. We might have to shorten it eventually. Mr. Speaker, insults aside, you know, I think it's very clear that what the member talks about is a loan, not a grant, a loan that is fully secured on a property that's worth more than what's been dedicated by the province. We've put forward over 700 documents, Mr. Speaker, that verify and confirm that. Now what we're looking for, Mr. Speaker, is advice from Michael Nebrega and Carol Stevenson on what's the best path forward on a project, Mr. Speaker, that had some challenges during the recession. And, Mr. Speaker, we're looking forward to that advice. I'm not sure why the member continues to try to use question period just to hurl insults at us.
Answer.
We should take a look at what we've done and what we're trying to do to ensure that this project moves forward on a positive way.
Kent, supplementary.
Minister, I've heard your excuses for many months now, and nobody believes you, and especially your fairy tale happy ending, especially not a constituent of mine, Jim Buchanan. Jim Buchanan was told that even though he desperately needs a knee replacement, there's no money left at the hospital. The quota for knee replacements has been reached. Let me repeat that again. Well, a constituent of mine is told there is no money for a needed surgery. You and your government has blown millions on a glass palace for your bureaucrats. This sadly isn't a surprise anymore, just a disturbing reality and trend of your government's terrible mismanagement. Minister, do you not agree that the $400 million you've blown on Mars should have been better spent providing essential access to surgeries like knee replacements for Jim Buchanan and many,
Thank
many
you.
Others.
Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we all feel a very strong amount of support for the Minister of Health's work that he's doing to ensure that that we continue to invest more and more in health care. And I think the minister would tell you, if I had referred the question to him, that our wait times are down for knee replacements across this province as a result, Mr. Speaker, of the efforts we've made. But for the member, Mr. Speaker, to compare a totally repayable secured loan with somehow, Mr. Speaker, money that's been spent, either indicates that the member doesn't understand this issue after all the
member
time he's spent
Lanark
on it,
the question.
Or, Mr. Speaker, he's trying to make his constituent think something that's simply incorrect. Mr. Speaker, the fact is what we've invested in Phase 2 with Mars is a loan that's fully repayable, fully secured. We will move forward on a positive basis on this issue, and the member ought to start working constructively with us on this instead of inaccurate things like
that. New question, the member from Nickelbelt.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Ma question pour le ministre de la Santé des Soins.
Thank you. My question for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. The ability to communicate is very important with residents in homes for the elderly. They should be able to communicate in their own language. But Francophones in Domaville were not able to communicate in their language. They had to call on their children to interpret for them and translate for them. And this is not the only time that there is a case of Francophones not being able to receive care in their own language. How can it be that the ministry cannot answer a call in French in 2014? Minister of Long-Term Care.
The member opposite, it's important when we talk about French language services in this province. It's an imperative that all of us, and particularly us on the government side, do everything we can in a responsible way to provide those services. And I know, and I'm not sure if the reference was specifically to 911, and I know, Mr. Speaker, that the member opposite has already made myself and the Attorney General aware of some concerns, some legitimate concerns concerning translation services and the ability for a citizen of this province to converse, particularly, as you can imagine, in a 911 situation in the language of their choice. We are working on solving that particular issue, but there's also no doubt, and I've talked with the member opposite about other issues where we need to continue to strengthen. We need to make sure that we meet our responsibility, and it's a responsibility that I take very seriously, that we provide French language services throughout the healthcare system for the people that need it during those times.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you very much. A few years ago, as soon as the government subcontracted a service, there was an exemption from the need to provide service in French. And it's happened over and over again. The government has said that there is no longer any exemption. And starting in July 2014, government health services were subject to the law on services in French. But it would seem that there are still exemptions. The government said to the commissioner that if there is a health service subcontracted, there is no need to be in conformity with the law. This situation has been called a serious threat, and this is very right. Why does the minister call for so little commitment from the subcontracting services, and why are they exempted from the requirement to provide a French language service?
Minister responsible for Francophone Affairs.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Oui, la membre de Nickel Belt a une.
Yes, the member from Nickel Belt has a very good question. Services offered by the government and subcontracted to another organization must provide service in French. This has been a gap. And we're improving the situation. We've modified the measures in questions, and any organization offering services for the government of Ontario must provide services in French. And however, with regard to this particular question, there is a transition period during which the subcontractors will have to adapt to the new situation. I would like to congratulate the Minister of Health for his work to improve French language service.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister responsible for Seniors Affairs. Ministers, seniors are our lifeline to the past and our future. They play an active and important role in our province's communities and economy. Ontario is home to approximately 2 million people over the age of 65. Mr. Speaker, in my own riding of Halton, seniors are a thriving, active and incredibly engaged group in our community. However, as we all know, there are challenges that our seniors face as they grow old. Mr. Speaker, I recently joined the Minister for an important funding announcement for province-wide elderly person centres, including one in my own riding. These centres promote the safety, well-being and health of seniors in Ontario. Mr. Speaker, can the Minister please tell us about EPCs and why they are an important investment for our seniors?
Thank you. Minister responsible for seniors.
Speaker, thank you very much, and I want to thank the member from Halton for a very thoughtful question. Speaker, investing into the elderly person centres, it's only one of the many ways helping our seniors stay active, engaged and connected in their own community. Speaker, indeed, I'm very, very pleased to inform you and inform the legislature that Ontario is investing over $11.5 million supporting 265 elderly person centres located throughout our province, Speaker.
Wonderful.
Speaker, this is what I call investment at work for our seniors, investment to improve the quality of life of our seniors, to live a healthy and more meaningful and fulfilling life. Thank you, Speaker.
Supplementary, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I would like to thank the Minister for his response. Mr. Speaker, I recently had the pleasure of attending a coffee house social at the local Milton Senior Centre, which is receiving over $54,000 this year. Mr. Speaker, this centre is incredibly important to the well-being of seniors in Halton. Each time I visit, I am delighted to see firsthand the difference Elderly Person Centre's funding is making in my community. Mr. Speaker, the Milton Senior Centre has something for everyone. There are fitness classes, computer classes, arts and crafts, and so much more. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please elaborate on how funding for EPC is a key component of Ontario's action plan for seniors?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Again, I want to thank the member from Halton for the question. The EPC is only one, indeed, of the major components of the Ontario Action Plan for Seniors, Speaker. Out of the 265 elderly person centres, more than 60% are run by non-profit organisations and some 40% are run by local municipalities. Speaker, indeed, I visited the centre in Milton and I have to say that you are getting $54,000 in assisting them with their programmes. And if you really, Speaker, want to see our investment for seniors is working, you have to visit this particular centre in Milton, which is called the Coffee House Social. Speaker, seniors enthusiastically bursting with activities, fitness classes for every level of mobility, one-on-one computer classes, arts, crafting, knitting, dancing, music. This is what I call, Speaker, this is what's all about, caring and investing for our seniors. I thank you, Speaker.
Thank you.
There's more to come.
Question, the member from Bruce-Bury Owen Sound.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Earlier today, my leader, the member from Simcoe, shared with this House that $250 million in 4 years is spent with a new system that's supposed to support those most needy in our society. We also learned that this system is wrought with bugs and exploitable weaknesses. We also learned that the minister knew about the computer problems all along, but ignored staff.
Sorry, I did not get who the question was to.
To the Minister of Community and Social Services, Speaker.
Thank you.
We also learned that the minister knew about the computer problems all along, but ignored staff's warning, who summed up the computer situation in one simple word: chaos. In fact, not only were they ignored, but in estimates on November 4th, the minister, and I quote, said, "I feel fairly confident that the new system will have a pretty seamless rollout next week." Fairly confident and pretty seamless doesn't seem to equate to the reality of today, Mr. Speaker. Minister, it's your word against the front line.
Question.
Who is telling the truth?
Thank you. Minister of Community and Social Services.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member for Bruce-Bury Owen Sound to allow me the opportunity to reiterate what the Premier said so very clearly earlier in question period. This new computer system is state-of-the-art. It is a very large and involved system, clearly. It has taken many, many months of training of many staff to get into good working order. But I want to assure the member opposite that the concerns that were raised earlier in the summer by the presidents of QP and OPSU were taken extremely seriously by officials in my ministry, and that's why we accelerated some of the training that was provided. Again, some 11,000 users were trained in some 257 offices. There is no chaos whatsoever. Individuals receive.
Member from Hamilton Mountain, come to order, please.
And the final number will be getting them today. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Again, to the Minister of Community and Social Services. Will Minister, state of the art, I think Sam should sadly be, sadly, another money scandal coming at us.
Yep.
The Minister is told where eHealth was. Two was working out glitches until the billion-dollar scandal surfaced. The fact is, your government has a track record of asleep at the switch oversight. In the case, this specific case of oversight, mistaken payments were sent to 6,000 social service recipients to a tune of at least $300,000. Minister, we want to restrike the Standing Committee on Estimates so we can recall witnesses and get to the bottom of this, and we hope you'll actually adhere to this time so we can ensure that this does not turn into another e-health boondoggle. Minister, will you support the striking of the Standing Committee on Estimates so we can get to the truth?
Good idea. Let's hear from the employee.
Well, again, to set the record straight, the new system processed both the Ontario Works and Ontario Disability Support Program monthly payments to some 570,000 individuals totally successfully. As the Premier has stated earlier, there were a small number of overpayments. Those on direct deposit, some 85% of individuals received their payments through direct deposit. Those were changed and the correct amount deposited within 24 hours. Of the few remaining who do receive paper checks, they are being issued new checks today. We are down to contacting some 119 people as of 10:30 this morning. We have coped with this very small glitch in an extremely effective way, and I'd like to, in fact, thank all the frontline workers that were so diligent.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. In Sudbury, there are 30-ton mining trucks that are constantly driving along LaSalle Boulevard, a main shopping street, because it's the only way that the trucks can travel between the mine site and the smelter. Sudbury officials want to extend Mailey Drive so that the slurry trucks don't have to mix with shoppers and residents, Speaker. People of Sudbury have set aside millions of dollars for this top priority project. The government has repeatedly promised to fund the project. It was right there in their budget. But so far, not a single dollar has flowed. Once again, we have a promise, but no action. So when will the provincial government actually keep its promise to the people of Sudbury and fund the project?
Thank you, Premier.
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Mr. Speaker, the leader of the third party would be aware that before the election we brought forward a budget that committed to moving forward on this project. She didn't support that. She made us go through an election, so we brought forward the budget again. So she had a second chance to support this project, Mr. Speaker, and she failed to do that. Because in the second budget we brought forward, this project was clearly identified as a government priority, as we recognized it was a priority for the community of Sudbury. Now you're getting up, Mr. Speaker, to tell us you support the project. Thank you for your support, but Mr. Speaker, we've got it in hand. It's a commitment we made in the budget. It's a commitment we will fulfill, and we're looking forward to moving on it as soon as we can.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Speaker. Gee, all that talk and still no action. Where's the money is the question, Speaker. The people of Sudbury have been waiting over 10 years for Mailey Drive to be extended. They've waited long enough, Speaker. They have set aside...
Stop the talk, please. Minister of Aboriginal Affairs, come to order. The Minister of the Environment and Climate Change, come to order. Please finish.
The people of Sudbury have set aside their share of the project money. It's time for the government to pay its share. Will this government stop playing games, stop talking a good game, and actually ante up the funding for the extension of Mailey Drive in Sudbury?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I guess I want to know which budget do you want me to refer to, the one that you rejected and sent us to an election on, or the one that we passed with our majority here in this House that you oppose? Both of them, Mr. Speaker, referred to Mailey Drive as a commitment of $26.7 million for the first phase of expansion for Mailey Drive. We're committed to the project. We'll be moving on the project, Mr. Speaker, and I'm looking forward very soon, Mr. Speaker, to moving on it. We are in discussions with the federal government with regard to federal funding. It could be part of that, Mr. Speaker. It may not be. It all depends. We've just received information after asking since March from the federal government with regard to the details of the federal program, and we expect, Mr. Speaker, to be able to move forward soon. But, Mr. Speaker, we don't have a date as of yet.
Thank you. New question. The member from Ottawa South.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Transportation. Often in this House, we speak about transit in the GTHA. I know there are many investments being made here, whether it's Eglinton Crosstown, UP Express, or GO Transit. The problem, Mr. Speaker, is that there are those who say our government is only investing in Toronto Transit, stating that those types of key investments aren't being made in other parts of the province. In my community of Ottawa South, people care very much about their transit and transportation. They rely on OC Transpo to get to work, school, doctor's appointments, all those things people do in their daily lives. Mr. Speaker, my community wants to know that our government is committed to investing in transit all across the province, including Ottawa South. Can the minister please tell members of this House what the government is doing to invest in transit and transportation in other parts of Ontario?
Question. Thank you. Minister of Transportation.
Thank you very much.
Je voudrais remercier le député de Toronto Sud.
And I appreciate the question because, of course, Speaker, I've heard some of the same concerns, and I know that Ontarians want to know that our government is investing right across the province, not just here in the GTHA. Speaker, as you know, we have a bold $29 billion 10-year plan called Moving Ontario Forward, which will invest in transit and transportation infrastructure right across the province. And we've already delivered in other ways. Using the members' region in particular, Speaker, our government is investing in the Ottawa LRT. We've invested $600 million in that project. This is the single largest investment ever made to that city's public transit system from the provincial government. But we're also investing in local transit all over Ontario, Speaker, by providing municipalities with permanent gas tax funding to support their transit growth. Speaker, whether it's Moving Ontario Forward or gas tax funding, we are committed to building all of Ontario up.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank the minister for his response. It's good to know that our government is committed to making transit investments count in Ottawa. The Ottawa LRT is a great project that will help commuters get moving across the city. Mr. Speaker, the minister mentioned that our government is supporting local transit systems through gas tax funding. I know that Ottawa received over $33 million in gas tax funding this year to support public transit. Mr. Speaker, could the minister please tell the members of this House more about the gas tax program and how it can help those living in our communities?
Thank you. Minister.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I want to thank that member again for that outstanding question. Just a number of days ago, I was happy to announce the amount of gas tax funding being provided to municipalities this year to support their local transit. The member mentioned that Ottawa is receiving over $33 million in gas tax funding, but I want to highlight the fact that over $321 million is being provided to communities all over Ontario. This means that municipalities, whether it's Ottawa, Waterloo, Windsor, or Sudbury, Speaker, will be able to continue investing in their local transit systems. Through the 2013 budget, our government made 2 cents on every litre of gas, a permanent source of funding for municipalities. This funding demonstrates that our government is committed to improving public transit all over Ontario. And
never
we'll continue to work closely with our municipal partners to make sure that wherever they are, Speaker, that we continue to make those investments in transportation that matter to Ontarians. Thanks very much, Speaker.
New question, the member for Dufferin-Caledon.
My question is to the Minister of Health. In responding to my leader's question earlier today, you said you would, quote, personally address any issues with specific clients who say they are not getting the care they need. Minister, I have a letter from you from last week saying you cannot intervene in matters concerning the provision of CCAC home care. So which is it? You can address specific issues or you can't?
Well, Mr. Speaker, the member opposite knows that I'm happy to sit down anytime with any member of this legislature and speak about individual cases that, if they feel that that individual is not receiving the support that they require, that's part of my job. It's a responsibility that I take very seriously. So I'm happy to, if there are specific instances with the member opposite, I'm more than happy to sit down with her and see what we can do. Now, obviously, Mr. Speaker, from time to time, reassessments are made of individuals in home care. Sometimes those individuals require more care based on the assessment, and sometimes they require a little bit less. So those are some of the changes that naturally occur within a home care system that we're continuing to fund. But Mr. Speaker, I certainly would offer, I would encourage the member opposite to sit down with me and discuss particulars.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Minister, then you better block off a week, because I deal with these CCAC questions all the time in the constituency office. We need to know when we write you that you're actually going to do something about it.
That's
the
right.
CCAC is funded 100% by your ministry. Our constituents need to know when they need home care, it will be there. Will you commit to review the decision by Central West CCAC to ensure their budget is being used for frontline care? And when MPPs write you on behalf of our constituents, you will not dismiss us out of hand.
Good question. Minister of Health, long-term care.
Well, you know, Mr. Speaker, the members on all sides of this legislature know, those who have come forward and worked with me in a cooperative fashion on individual cases, whether it's to do with home care or any situation with regards to health care, they know that I work as hard as I can and constructively. Party politics does not get into this in any fashion, Mr. Speaker. And so I would again encourage the member to sit down with me and talk about the particulars. But the reality, the truth is, Mr. Speaker, we are investing $4 billion-plus dollars in home and community care. We're doing the best that we can with our local LHINs, the LHINs that, of course, are the objects the party, the official opposition, would have got rid of in the first place, and the LHINs with our CCACs to make sure that we're providing the care to those who need it most. Now, we obviously, as with all that we do with government, we have budgets, but the budget for our CCACs, Mr. Speaker, is going up as we continue to move care closer to where people live.
Thank you. New question. The member from Etobicoke North.
To the President, my question is for the Minister of Agriculture.
Feed cities. And we in the government recognize that they are an integral part of our $34 billion agri-food industry. But if this already important industrial sector is going to continue to grow, to flourish, and to compete globally, more needs to be done in partnership by both government and industry. In October 2013, the Premier challenged Ontario's agri-food industry to double its growth rate and create more than 120,000 new jobs by 2020. This challenge is an opportunity to demonstrate how this sector makes an important and essential contribution to our economy and our quality of life. Minister, can you update this House, citing your own remarks to industry leaders at the Premier's annual Agri-Food Summit? What is the status of the challenge?
Thank you. Minister of Agriculture, Rural Affairs and Food.
Good question. That was an excellent question.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. And I want to thank the member from Etobicoke Court for a very thoughtful question this morning. Just last week, the Premier and I had the opportunity to participate in the 9th Premier's Agri-Food Summit, along with many members from outside the House. Our government fully supports growth, investment, and innovation opportunities in the province's agri-food sector. Mr. Speaker, I just want to give you a bit of an update. Since the Premier issued the challenge last year, Ontario has created 17,000 new jobs in the agri-food sector in Ontario and increased our exports by $1.1 billion. There is always more to do. Our critical path to growth requires government and industry to play a role. That's why we're working with our industry partners to establish a growth measurement system to help identify opportunities and measures progress through the new Growth Steering Committee. It will bring together industry and government leaders and experts to identify opportunities to help the industry meet the growth challenge.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister. The numbers, commitment and energy all demonstrate a formidable political will. Speaker, it's apparent that in the year since the Premier's Agri-Food Challenge was issued, the agri-food sector has done remarkable things. Building on the success of last year, the new Growth Steering Committee will assist in driving the agri-food industry's growth and create jobs right across the province. Nevertheless, Minister, many Ontarians across the province are concerned about red tape, what it means for Ontario farmers, and how it might potentially stand in the way of meeting the Premier's challenge. This is especially so in the light of the government's recent decision around neonicotinoids. I repeat, neonicotinoids, which are a class of neurologically active insecticides similar in chemical structure to good old nicotine. Minister, what is our response to people who claim that government is increasing regulation at a time when we are tasked with growing the agri-food industry?
Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I really want to thank the member from Etobicoke North and his great interest in the agricultural sector in the province of Ontario. And I know all of us are always very concerned about regulatory burdens and what impact that might have on Ontario's farmers. As you know, there's many people in Ontario today that are concerned about the challenge we face to reduce the use of neonics, which we announced last week. I want to be very clear, and this is what Premier Wynne said at the Agri-Food Summit last week. It's not about some kind of agenda that would lead to more regulatory burden for Ontario's farmers. We are committed to addressing the challenges of producers as we develop and implement new controls. We also remain committed to work with our farmers in Ontario with our very successful Open for Business Forum to reduce red tape for our agricultural sector.
Answer.
We've had many more successes on that front, and we want to achieve more. Addressing red tape, being environmental stewards, and growing the industry together, Mr. Speaker, very important to Ontario.
Thank you. New question. The member from Oxford.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing. Minister, you require all affordable housing corporations in Ontario to purchase services through the Housing Services Corporation, which of course is your appointed corporation. The problem is that this organization funds their operating expenses, including almost $6.5 million in salary, by charging social service housing organizations a premium on the services such as natural gas and insurance. We've heard from multiple municipalities that they would save money by purchasing directly. In some cases, millions of dollars that could go into affordable housing. They asked you if they could opt out. So why are you forcing them to give money to the Housing Corporation and not let them buy it at the best price they can get?
Thank you. Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm only aware of one municipality that's asked for the option to opt out. And we took a serious look at that and discovered that the economies of scale for all the other municipalities would be so discouragingly hurt by that that the decision was taken not to do that. We've communicated that with the municipality that made that request, and that's at the moment our position, unless and until we get other information that may cause us to rethink it.
I appreciate the member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek for his activities today and the fact that he's wearing his hat. I'd like to give him permission to wear it for the whole day. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recess until 1 p.m. this afternoon.